What is up, my beautiful gemstones? Welcome back to my channel. And if you're new here, just welcome. My name is Gemma Jade, but today we are going to be discussing military encounters with outlandish creatures and extraterrestrials. And I also threw a little bit of an extra something something on the end there as well, because recently I brought to you all encounters with UFOs on battlefields, and my comments section and email blew up with so many of you telling me you loved that video and that type of content. So in wanting to keep you all happy and to keep that momentum going, I decided to do a kind of continuation of that video in a way and talk about outlandish humanoids, extraterrestrials, things like that, that were also encountered by the military. So not necessarily on battlefields, but by the military. We know that war itself brings with it so many horrors, right? The bloodshed, the killing, the violence, all of it and more will take its toll on the human beings involved. And sometimes it takes an even larger toll on their psyches. Sometimes, though, people involved in these wars encounter strange forces and entities that are even worse than the war and atrocities that come with it in the first place. Soldiers aren't typically trained to deal with this type of thing, and in fact, it's highly likely that most of them would have been conditioned not to focus on the types of things we're going to be talking about today and that we normally discuss here on this channel. Level-headed and conditioned for battle. I don't really see many soldiers who would be willing to accept encountering something like what we're going to be delving into today. These soldiers, these military personnel, they came across inscrutable beings and other things just like that, far beyond the realm of human understanding, and they live to tell about it, though. I'm sure glad they decided to come forward with their encounter stories and can only imagine how many stories there are out there that people are holding in and withholding from the public just out of fear of being ridiculed and or not believed, losing their professional reputations, losing so much in their personal lives, right? Really nothing to be gained. Especially for someone who is involved somehow with the military, soldiers as well, who come forward with these types of things because for whatever reason, they just can't keep it in anymore. They don't want to keep it in anymore, or they think the public should know, right? There's a myriad of reasons they would do this. So remember to be respectful in the comments, but make sure you do comment because I love reading through them and seeing what you all come up with in cases like this. With all that being said, let's jump right in. So our first encounter is relatively obscure, and it happened in October of 1943 among the death, chaos, and destruction of the Germans bombing London during World War II. Citizens were cowering in their homes, terrified and not knowing when the next shutters from the next bombs were going to come. And outside of those same homes, a military group called the ARP, the Air Raid Precautions, were stomping through the streets. These people were picking through the rubble and the disaster, trying desperately to find any survivors so that they could hopefully salvage as many lives as they possibly could from all of the terror. One of the men from the ARP was named Howard Leland, and he couldn't have known that he was about to find something worse and far more harrowing than anything he could have expected to find that day. In fact, he found something in this war-torn wasteland of a city far worse than even the enemy had caused. That's kind of a relative thing. Y'all are going to believe whatever you want to is worse, and it depends on what you believe in. But for me, it's like they were expecting to find a bunch of casualties. They were expecting to find people who were barely alive buried under the rubble. They were not expecting this. So at one point, the ground shook due to a bomb that had gone off particularly close to where Leland and his team were, and he decided to duck into one of the many abandoned homes in the area, thinking that if he didn't, he would more than likely be injured by the bomb and thereby rendered useless to anyone already buried under the rubble who would eventually need his help. The abandoned house had debris and dust raining down into it and utter destruction and chaos raining all around the outside of it, and it quaked with the shudder of another bomb detonating nearby. It was nighttime, and so he decided to use his flashlight to try and get a look at what was all around him inside of this abandoned home. He really didn't see much except the dust and particles from the devastation dancing macabrely in the beam as it cut through the murky-looking air. He made his way up and eventually got to the top of a dark stairwell that descended down into what looked like, to him at that point at least, a never-ending black pit or hole that his flashlight was useless in illuminating down into. He decided to go down there anyway, despite the terrible feelings overwhelming him at the time. I mean, I can't really blame him because I'm sure he didn't feel much other than terrible throughout this whole ordeal that night. It wasn't like a sudden surge of doom and devastation would have given him cause to stop, or that it was anything so highly unusual that he recognized it as something different than what he had been experiencing all along. He stumbled down into the cellar that was at the bottom of that pit, and he crouched down in a corner to wait for the enemy to be done with the most recent run of bombs. He was praying that the building he was in wouldn't fall down on top of him because of the bombing and the aftershocks left in their wake. He waited and waited for the bombing to stop or to die himself. He knew eventually one or the other would happen first. But then he got a very strong feeling that he was being watched from the darkness. Then the thick sense of dread that came along with that feeling was so strong, he finally noticed it. I mean, like I said, I doubt the feelings of dread and doom were anything new, but Leland said that these particular feelings were something altogether different. While being in war made those types of feelings make sense, this was something altogether different, more primal, and he couldn't figure out why he was suddenly so very terrified. As he sat there, he decided the eyes on him had to have been coming from the top of the stairs, or I guess he just hoped that's where they were coming from, because that's where he decided to shine the flashlight first. There, at the top of the stairs, the beam illuminated a horrifying and shocking sight. Crouched on the top step was a massive beast that resembled some sort of dark giant cat. It had very large iridescent eyes and horns protruding from its head. Leland later said that the monstrous creature exuded, quote, an aura of evil, end quote, with unblinking eyes that hypnotized him and held him in some sort of trance. He could only sit there, lost for a few moments in the gaze of this otherworldly evil, until finally it jumped and pounced down the steps toward him. It had an otherworldly growl that didn't sound like anything of this earth, and as it bounded down the steps towards him, it was all he could hear. However, before it hit the ground and attacked him, it suddenly and all at once disappeared into thin air. Only then was he finally broken from the trance he had been in since the moment he had first spotted it. At the same exact time he was in control of his senses again, he heard footsteps and voices and realized that some of the other ARP soldiers had finally come to his rescue. He immediately started to tell them what had just happened because he was still panicking and not thinking normally, but none of the other men saw anything strange in the house or at all. Well, they never reported seeing anything strange, but honestly, who knows if that's true or not. They also said they didn't hear the horrifying and otherworldly sounds the animal was making as it pounced and disappeared either. Those particular men reported having seen nothing sinister like that, but much to his surprise, there were other men in the general unit who said that they had seen a very similar shadowy cat-like beast with horns and glowing eyes, and that other people, civilians in the area, had reported seeing the exact same thing as well. This really was affecting this guy Leland, so much so that he visited a clairvoyant named John Pendragon, who was immediately able to divine the location of the home on a map of London. Some digging into the previous owners of the house and the land was done, and it was found that one of the former owners had been an occultist and a practitioner of dark magic who had routinely sacrificed cats for his dark arcane rituals. This person had gone insane and took his own life by hanging himself in the home at the top of those same stairs where our witness saw the demonic creature for the first time. After his death, the cat monster slash figure had been seen from time to time by several people in the area, and especially during the war as well. This clairvoyant then told Leland that because of all that they were able to understand about what went on in that home, about the owner and everything, that Leland had seen some sort of elemental entity, a spirit or a demon, that had taken on the form of a feline due to the absorption of its eternal soul of the violence against the cats that had seeped into and become a part of the structure itself. I don't know and can't say with any certainty here what happened, guys, but what the clairvoyant says does make sense to me for the most part. From 1955 to 1975, during the Vietnam War, I found a case of some very demonic creatures on the Phantom and Monsters website. That's Lon Strickler's website, for those of you who don't know, and I get a lot of stories and encounters from there throughout my research, specifically about entities in the woods, but also about other things too, like what we're discussing here today. The witness said he was an army corporal during the war, and that in 1970, he was second in command to a squad of soldiers who were operating in a very remote, very thick jungle area just south of the DMZ, which is demilitarized zone. The witness said he set up a temporary camp without tents or covers in an area of steep hills before setting out at night to patrol the surrounding areas. Very normal, usual thing for them to do in that situation. The men encountered what they at first thought was enemy activity, and they hunkered down to wait it out. During that time, as they sat there in silence, waiting for the enemy to pass through, they kept getting fleeting glimpses of something moving through the brush around them. Once the activity died down, they continued through the valley and along the way they had previously been on, when they eventually came to a sheer wall of stone that looked, somehow, like someone had stacked enormous boulders in front of it. A cave entrance was also visible from where they were, and it looked as though it had been clearly and very cleanly carved into the rock, meaning the entrance. It looked nothing like anything they had been familiar with regarding enemy caves, and they wanted to investigate it more, so they continued towards it to check it out. As they got closer to the cave's entrance, the men described a disgusting stench, which they described as being like, quote, rotting eggs and human decay, end quote, began overwhelming the whole area. They could easily tell that the rotten stench was coming from the cave, and it was so bad that several of the men began vomiting right there on the spot in the bushes. The men decided to take up positions in the jungle nearby to the cave to watch and wait it out and see if maybe they could see who it belonged to or what it was being used for. However, almost right away, they started to hear strange rumbling sounds that seemingly were coming from below the ground, and then something very strange happened. One witness explained it by saying, quote, "Just then we noticed movement in front of the cave. A being, I first thought it was a man, moved through the entrance into the clearing in front of the cave. As it stood up from crouch, it stood at least 7 feet high and started to look in our direction. At that time, another similar-looking creature was moving out of the cave. They were making hellish hissing sounds and looking directly at us. The only way I can describe these beings is that they looked like upright lizards. The scaly, shiny skin was very dark, almost black, snake-like faces with forward-set eyes that were very, very large. They had arms and legs like a human, but with scaly skin. I didn't notice a tail, though they wore long, one-piece dark green robes, along with a dark cap-like covering on their heads. I never noticed if they had anything on their feet. No one gave the order. It seemed like the entire squad opened fire at once. Every piece of vegetation between us and them was quickly sheared away. I yelled out a ceasefire order at the same time I was looking in the direction of the cave. There was nothing there. We immediately checked our flank in case these things circled around us, but there was nothing. As we approached the cave, ready to resume action if needed, it became apparent that the beings had escaped, most likely back inside of the cave. It was soon decided to set charges and close the cave entrance. When we returned to camp, we all seemed to be in a daze. There was little discussion of the incident, and we were never debriefed, so I know the sergeant never filed a report. Then again, if he did, it was kept quiet by the brass, end quote. So guys, this is not the first time, as many of you will know if you've watched my videos about encounters with reptilians or lizard men, the reptilian race of extraterrestrial species, etc., that I've seen an encounter where someone came across a random and weird looking cave, and inside were reptilian lizard people. And from the moment the cave came into the story, I just had a feeling that's what it was going to be. As bizarre as it is, it's also quite common. I've also come to the understanding that these things aren't only super fast when they need to be, but that they also basically vibrate however they need to in order to be able to come and go as they please as well. Meaning, they were more than likely going to attack those soldiers knew they were there, but at the same time could be injured by the gunfire and therefore decided that they needed to get out of there ASAP. At first, I thought that maybe they had just simply cloaked themselves, but they still would and could have gotten shot and possibly injured. So, in my opinion, I think it's more likely they skipped out and possibly started vibrating differently and or that they passed through a portal. The energetic vibration of extraterrestrial intelligences is something that I'm very new to learning about, so I can't explain it all, but there are many theories. They didn't stick around to try and get at these men, even though they were clearly either trying to scare them or at the very least interested in eating them or something. And by the way, here's a little known fact. Some reptilian races are actually known to eat human beings. Yes, I know how ridiculous that sounds. And of course, you don't have to believe me, but I do know it for absolute certain. Though most of them just feed off of our fear and terror they make us feel. It depends on the species, and I also believe they all look different depending on the species, just like with anything else. I've often seen darker ones without tails looking to literally tear into our flesh, where the ones who look more like actual lizards do here on Earth, only humanoid and much, much larger, are the more militant ones who merely fuel themselves with fear and terror. However, it didn't escape my notice that these beings were spotted smack dab in the middle of war, because from what I know about them, they are almost all militant, and I've even come across some information that they could have been biologically engineered by another race of ETs for the purposes of winning wars and overtaking societies. So I don't really know what I believe here to the core of the encounter, guys. But I do know that I absolutely believe this encounter is true. And I'm sure that if I looked hard enough and for long enough, I would find many other encounters in that same place at that same time of people who came across something very similar, if not the exact same thing. Also, I'm not surprised in the least that this was never mentioned or that it was covered up by the higher ups and that no one really ever talks about it again. And obviously it was never made public. This brings me to my next encounter where the witness saw something incredibly sinister, something which he thought to be demonic in nature. And again, it doesn't surprise me that something deeply evil and malevolent would be hanging around a war zone. These creatures, these demons, entities, dark spirits, etc., whatever you choose to call them, feed off of our suffering, our terror, and our fear. So what better place than somewhere where people are all suffering and killing one another and where innocent civilians and the most innocent of all, the children, are also being slaughtered, than for something like this to happen? It just makes sense. Gross sense, but sense. Most adults alive today know about the early 2000s and the war in Afghanistan. In 2004, a man named Jerry Aberdeen was stationed in Mosul, Nineveh province, and said he encountered a very strange and highly malevolent creature out there in those badlands. Here's what he had to say about his experience. Quote, I was attached to 2/3 infantry, 3 SBCT FOB Patriot. Sorry, guys, I don't know military terms. A call went out from the radio that FOB Diamondback, the airfield, was under attack. Everyone on every FOB, from Courage, Blickenstaff, Patriot, and Merez, jumped into the closest vehicle and headed to the airfield to counter the attack. I was in a vehicle with some other infantry guys, an engineer, and a psych ops guy. When we got to the airfield, we saw some dudes trying to climb over the wall. The gunner opened up on them and the rest of us took up a position in a ditch on the other side of the road and we opened fire. There were three of us side by side, the engineer, the psyops guys, and myself. We fired on one guy and he dropped from the top of the wall. Hard to tell who actually shot him. Right after he fell, there was a stream of black smoke that started coming out of him. The engineer made that comment that he must have been wearing a suicide vest and it malfunctioned. A few seconds later, the black smoke grew larger and started to take a human-looking form. What happened next, all three of us saw, and there was no doubt of it. The now fully materialized black smoke was standing upright and now had red, smoky, glowing eyes and a weird-looking mouth. The damn thing actually smiled at us and turned to sort of run, but it just dissipated after it took a few steps. Very hard to describe how it all happened. All three of us just looked at each other wide-eyed for a second or two. After it was all over, we only spoke about it once and then never again, end quote. I want to stay in the vein of the war in Afghanistan for a few minutes because I've also come across a couple of few reports of people actually seeing actual vampires over there, specifically while stationed there during the war. If you've been following my channel for a while or know me personally, then you would know why this particularly piqued my interest. I'm obsessed with finding evidence of real vampires and learning what they're all about. in real life, IRL. So when I started hearing that people were seeing them over there, of course, I had to look more into it. About this encounter that we just discussed, I mean, obviously, maybe not so obviously, I shouldn't have said that, but for a lot of people, people like myself, we do believe that bombers sent in that go in with the intention of taking their own lives, they think that they're doing it for one reason, they really are being used as tools for the demonic or for the devil. And you can disagree with me, and I don't have a problem with that. You know, I can't prove anything I know, so I just kind of take the opposition in stride. There's nothing more I can do. So a former U.S. Marine turned investigative journalist slash reporter named Tim King spent months in Afghanistan combat theater and covered a whole variety of different military operations for SalemNews.com and Oregon's KPTV Fox 12. He wrote an article for the Salem News in 2007 titled Vampires in Afghanistan? Soldiers Say It's True. King said that in his travels, he met with a soldier at the Bagram airfield that told him a seriously strange encounter story. First, the soldier asked him if he was aware of the, quote, vampire problem in the area, and King responded that he had never heard of such a thing in all of his time spent there. He wanted more information, and the soldier was more than willing to speak to him about it, claiming there were real vampires that lived deep in that desert. He said they were a lot taller than normal human beings, and that they were more often than not females. He also said that people local to the area have known about the vampires in the deserts for centuries, and that they came out of the desert badlands and mountains at night looking for victims to feed on. The vampires were almost exclusively blamed for a problem with people seeming to vanish off the face of the earth in that area all of the time as well, like an inordinate number of people all from the same area, constantly just going missing. Like, you went in that area, you were done for, especially at night. The soldier continued talking to King and said, quote, they are really terrified of them. It scares people half to death if they just think one is around. They come out at night. Sometimes people come up missing, especially kids. They even pull their animals inside when the vampires are out. It's been going on for hundreds of years here. People in other parts of the world don't even know about it, but anyone who has lived around here does. Guys are scared. You're damned right. They know there isn't a thing anyone can do about it if one of them decides to come after you, so you just stick with other people and hope for the best sometimes. End quote. I have to admit, I was a bit disappointed with this encounter, as that's how it was labeled. It was labeled as though someone had encountered a vampire, but really it was just a legend. But I did feel the need to include it here because I'll be adding it to my long list of things to research into for future videos here on this channel. So I'll look more into it and see if maybe I can come up with some actual encounters. Definitely interesting, though. Something vampiric, an actual vampiric vampire in a war zone. But one that's always there. It is something to think about, guys, if you catch my drift. If you're picking up what I'm putting down, so to speak. Another creature, if that's what you want to call it, that I've seen many times come across my desk and in my emails that's said to be seen near military bases a lot of the time is, believe it or not, Bigfoot. Notice I didn't say these experiences and encounters were on the battlefield, and I did that for this reason. I wanted to broaden the horizon of the subject a little bit because there have been such outlandish sounding encounters with so many different creatures, spirits, and beings all over the place on battlefields, but also in other military zones and in areas involving the military, like their bases as well. Let's start with the 1970s encounter that's said to have happened at the Fort Lewis U.S. Army military installation in Washington State. This place is surrounded by a sprawling and dense, very untamed wilderness area. In 1978, a soldier named Edwin Godoy was on base grounds and on his way back from some training exercises at night, and he was with some of his platoon mates and friends when they had the encounter. They were riding in a truck, and suddenly, without any warning, it sputtered out and came to a stop. It was 8 at night, and no matter what the men did, they just couldn't get the truck started again, and so they decided to go back to the base on foot. However, Edwin had been the one to sign the truck out that day, and so he knew he would be responsible for it regardless of the situation or circumstances, and so he decided to stay behind with the truck and wait for it to be towed in the morning. I don't really understand why the other soldiers wouldn't just send help or a tow truck as soon as they got back to their base, but they didn't, and probably everything was shut down or something like that at that time. It was the 70s, I really don't know. Edwin sat in the truck all night trying to sleep, but because he was surrounded by the forest, he kept hearing strange noises that were very normal, but that kept him awake and on alert anyway. That is until around midnight, when all of the usual and normal sounds ceased and there was nothing but silence ringing in his ears. Being a soldier, I guess, he knew that when that happens, he definitely would need to be on high alert, and it didn't take long for his attention to be drawn toward a figure lumbering around in the bushes, stopping to loom near some trees about 300 meters from where he was in the truck. He couldn't completely see it, not clearly anyway, but he could make out that it was incredibly tall, incredibly broad, and it was covered with what looked like hair all over its body. He said the eyes were really eerie and they had a glow or like a glint to them. He described it as, quote, swaying its body sideways, end quote, and Edwin also said that it was staring directly at him, which caused him, for whatever reason, to be extremely terrified and panicked. Suddenly and without warning, the massive creature started to run directly towards Edwin in the truck, and he described it by saying, quote, that thing started running towards me, so I shouted a halt three times, asking that thing to stop and identify itself. As it wouldn't reply, I made a first shot to the air, and then I shot at him or it, I don't know how to call it. The hairy thing grabbed its chest and emitted a loud moan, stopped, and then ran to his right, disappearing into the forest, end quote. Guys, remember, this is a soldier that was stuck out there, surrounded by the dense and dark forest the creature he had just shot at had gone running back into after he had shot at it. He was still stuck out there. He still couldn't leave. It was late at night, in the middle of the night, and he had no way to get out of there except to go on foot, though he knew it would be almost of no consequence and provide almost no protection should that massive hulking beast come back, or worse, come back with its friends. He locked himself in the truck as at least some sort of safety and protective measure against whatever was out there. He didn't sleep at all that night, and when the tow truck finally arrived at 6 in the morning, he was still wide awake and clutching his weapon. I guess he was still in shock because he started immediately blurting to the tow truck drivers what had transpired, and at first they didn't believe him. However, once they went to the trees where Edwin said the thing had first been standing and watching him, they were surprised to find gigantic footprints right at that spot. The footprints had to have come from something extremely heavy and massive because of how they were pressed into the ground the way they were. Blood was also found on the ground, somewhat surprisingly, and they assumed that was from when he had shot the creature. The story doesn't end there, and it gets even more bizarre if you can believe it. I want to interject for a moment, though, and I want to say that I'm more surprised about the fact that a Bigfoot creature allowed itself to be shot in the first place. But this is why I always tell you I'm convinced that there are many different kinds of Bigfoots and that they all have different intentions, different temperaments, and that they all come from somewhere different. Most that I've heard of are impervious to bullets, and I believe that most of them are, but that either something went very wrong here for the Bigfoot, or that it was just a different breed that didn't have the ability to shield itself properly, if at all. All right, let's get back to Edwin Godoy's story now. According to him, the mechanics working on the truck started whispering into their radios, making a call to someone, but he never heard what transpired. However, the next thing he did know, a bunch of men in lab coats showed up on the scene as the mechanics fixed the truck. So it wasn't explained very well in my source materials, but the men who came to tow the vehicle were working on it right there on the spot, I think. But the men in the lab coats started looking all through the woods, taking samples of the spilled blood and some other things. Godoy couldn't really tell what they were doing. They wore thick rubber gloves and told him he wasn't allowed to speak to anyone else or tell the story of what had happened to him that night before to anyone. He also said he was kept to the side and far out of the way of whatever it was the men in the lab coats were doing in those woods. He was confused, but he didn't really have much time to process anything that had happened or that was currently going on because he was very quickly whisked away to the hospital where he was examined by an Air Force doctor. That's odd in and of itself because, remember, this was an Army installation where it all happened. The doctor was ranked a full colonel, and he didn't disbelieve Edwin's encounter. In fact, he was interested in hearing every single detail about it over and over again. The doctor was described as mysterious and seemed to be particularly concerned with any anomalous physical symptoms that Edwin might have been feeling at that time. He asked if he was feeling dizzy, if he had a headache, and if he was or had been nauseous during the encounter. encounter. He even asked if Edwin was experiencing any tingling sensations in his head or body, which our witness thought was really bizarre. He told the doctor he had experienced no such symptoms and he had been telling the truth. Once the doctor was satisfied with Godoy's answers, he then drew his blood and took a urine sample, and then he was ordered back to his barracks and told in no uncertain terms that he was never to ever mention what had happened to him. Not at all. Not ever. Did I mention? Not supposed to. Never. He wasn't supposed to tell anyone under any circumstances. Later on, Godoy was approached by a hospital staffer by the name of L. Robles, who had seemingly come to see him in secret. Godoy related what Robles said to him here. He recounted that Robles said, quote, "I, together with two other guys, had to analyze the blood samples taken from the ground, and we know you're the soldier involved because it was stated as such in the report. And you know, it's crazy, but what the hell was it you shot out there? When we examined the blood samples, we found three weird things in it. That blood contained human blood cells, animal blood cells, and chlorophyll." Man, that's incredible. What the hell was it? End quote. Edwin was a true soldier, or so it seemed, because he kept his promise not to discuss the encounter with anyone and refused to answer any of Robles' questions. He had a sense of duty, and he always carried it out, and he did what he was told. So this whole thing would have more than likely ended up hidden and forgotten somewhere in the annals of time and weird military history had it not been for a chance meeting Godoy had one day. He met a paranormal researcher by the name of George Martin from Puerto Rico. This happened many years later while our witness was vacationing with his wife in Cabo Rojo. Finally, he decided it was time to tell his story, and so he did, to Martine, and that's the reason we have it to discuss here now. This one was a lot for me, guys, so let me know what you all think in the comments below. I'm not surprised they've had samples of a Bigfoot's blood for at least this many years, right? We think that the hair that was found a couple decades ago or a decade ago was a big deal. They're never going to tell us what it is, okay? I don't know why, but they're never going to tell us what it is. That's just my opinion. You can disagree if you want to. I also wonder if Robles was sent to ask those questions to test Godoy to see if he was going to blab his mouth about it. And I wonder if he did, if we would be talking about another weird, mysterious military death on this channel. I just get that feeling, guys, that he was being set up. Because I want to cover all different types of entities and things here that have been allegedly encountered on military bases and other military areas, I'm going to do one more Bigfoot encounter and move on. But please know, there are dozens of them that I know about, and I'm sure hundreds more I've never even heard of floating out there if you know where to look. I found another account that happened in the 70s from a Bigfoot researcher by the name of Doug Trapp, and I found it on the Sasquatch Chronicles blog. Trapp interviewed various military personnel at Edwards Air Force Base in California. Everyone who spoke to him, every single person, did so under the condition and promise of anonymity, but he was able to piece together a really strange story of a Bigfoot that has been kind of haunting that area of the desert for years, possibly decades or longer. One of the people he interviewed was a lieutenant in charge of security in the sector of the base near Rogers Dry Lake, and he held that position at the base from 72 to 75. The anonymous lieutenant told Trapp that the base's security force used armed sentries most of the time, along with motion sensing equipment and starlight scopes, all on the lookout for trespassers wandering the area. Now, at the time, they were specifically looking for curiosity seekers who had become a common occurrence there due to all of the UFO conspiracies that had orbited that particular base for a very long time. The witness said that one night there was a perimeter breach and that the guard who detected it described the trespasser rather cryptically. He said the intruder was, quote, "a very tall man, but not really a man," end quote. When Trapp went to speak with the guard face-to-face to get more information, he ended up seeing that thing too and said about it, quote, "Through the starlight scope, he could clearly see that this was not a man. It was a very tall, hair-covered ape-like man walking through the desert. He said that the animal appeared to be looking at the desert floor in search of something. The animal was about 500 yards distant, but the scope was very powerful and tripod-mounted, so it could be observed clearly. Both men continued to observe the animal as it wandered around almost aimlessly. He then reported to his superiors of the activity and was told to keep the animal in sight. This was not a problem as the animal remained in the area. About 5 minutes later, a helicopter was heard approaching the area. Then it was seen coming in fast from the east." They continued to observe the animal, which continued its activity. The helicopter came in over a rock pile, then the animal spooked. It looked at the helicopter, turned, and, quote, ran like a deer, end quote, around a rock pile and out of sight, end quote. So, guys, is it just a coincidence or happenstance that there are Bigfoot entities lurking and roaming that close to and around military bases? Keeping in mind that these are just two of dozens of encounters. I'm not sure about this one, but I will say that in every encounter, they were near a base that was surrounded by woods. And I've yet to find an encounter where they were in or near ones that are like in the middle of the desert or something like that. That's not to say that those don't exist. I just haven't found any yet. So does that mean they just happen to come upon the bases because of where they live? I can't say one way or another. I would have to be more sure than I am that there aren't any encounters in the desert bases. And as of right now, I think it may be that I just haven't come across any, like I said. Let me know if any of you have any more information on that in the comments below, please. And let's move on. Military bases are secretive in nature as it is. And that's why I think the average person doesn't put too much thought into really what's going on in them behind the scenes or underground. We all know that they contain numerous levels of security clearances and are given the okay to work in the darkness, so to speak, beyond the levels of the public eye. Everything is classified regarding them, and most people are just okay with that and figure it's a matter of national security and public safety. I didn't want to end this video without discussing some encounters with actual extraterrestrials, or in the way we know them to be anyway, because I think many encounters with ETs are just that, only most people don't realize it because we call whatever the entity is something else. Does that make sense? I don't think Bigfoot is an extraterrestrial, but I'll use that as an example. We're calling it Bigfoot, but it's an ET. That's what I'm talking about here. We're calling them lizard men, but they're extraterrestrials. We call them the Greys, but we know they're ETs, right? That's the vein I'm thinking along here when I was writing this anyway. So I'm like, does that make sense? It made sense in my head as I wrote it, but I'm not so sure it'll translate well when I try to verbally ask the question. But okay, many military bases are the subjects of all types of different conspiracies. And in fact, I don't think there's a single military base, at least in the United States, that isn't the subject of some sort of speculation or that doesn't have a bunch of dark rumors connected to it about what's really going on there behind the scenes. These usually involve all sorts of dark experiments, top secret projects, and extraterrestrials themselves. I found a witness who said that he has had several encounters with extraterrestrials in secret underground facilities that are beneath two military bases in the United States. So let's talk about what this guy said. During a four-hour radio show broadcast covering UFO phenomenon from the KPFA-FM station in Berkeley, California, the first report was released and discussed at length. Now, the KPFA-FM station is part of the Pacifica Foundation, which was founded in 1947, and is a nonprofit organization that owns several non-commercial, mostly non-censored, alternative, listener-supported radio stations. These stations are known somewhat for largely being the very last place you can go to hear some real free speech and to listen in on the subjects that no one else wants to or is allowed to touch. They're the last bastion of free speech and activism, so to speak, and they're also pioneers of the First Amendment rights we are supposed to all have as citizens of this country. So with that being said, it makes sense that they would, or at least that some of the stations would, cover and be more open to hearing about fringe topics like extraterrestrials, UFOs, and people who come forward with stories like our witnesses who is claiming to have had a personal experience while working for the United States military. So according to the UFO researcher Elaine Douglas, KPFA-FM got a hold of an interview that was taken way back in 1981 of a man who said he was a Vietnam War veteran. He was a former Green Beret, military medal holder, and a construction contractor who had done work at many military facilities such as Nellis, Scott, Edwards, and Andrews Air Force bases, just to name a few. This is the man who's telling the story and our witness to numerous strange events and encounters at these places. He had two separate encounters, and the first one happened at the Edwards Air Force Base in the Antelope Valley of Southern California. Edwards Air Force Base is the home of the Air Force Test Center, the Air Force Test Pilot School, and NASA's Armstrong Flight Research Center, and it's also involved in all manner of research of the development of flight technology. So it's a pretty important place. I mean, in my opinion, all military bases are, but this one specifically, and we just talked about Edwards in one of the Bigfoot encounters as well. At Edwards, they also test and evaluate aerospace systems from concept to combat. Many experimental aircrafts are tested there, and Chuck Yeager's flight experiment where he broke the sound barrier did happen out of Edwards. According to our witness, there's also an expansive underground network of laboratories and tunnels that engage in top secret research that involves crashed UFOs, extraterrestrial spaceships, and aliens themselves. During the interview, the witness said that the underground facilities he had seen while working there were, quote, definitely not normal military structures, end quote, and that they had very thick concrete walls, strange-looking oval doorways with doors that electronically slid open and shut. Guys, as we go through all this, please keep in mind that the guy gave the interview in 81, and so this happened before then, and I'm sure things like electronic doors and doorways were very futuristic looking and odd to them at the time. He also said there was a ton of equipment unlike anything he had ever seen before, and that most of it looked very bizarre to him. He wasn't allowed to access many of the high security areas and labs, and said that the entire place gave off a sinister vibe where he didn't feel the slightest bit welcome at all. He couldn't say for sure what the size of the facility was, but he estimated, judging by the time it took to get from the top of the elevator to the bottom, that it went down at least 30 stories into the ground. He was walking through the halls one day with a colleague, and they accidentally wandered into an area where they immediately felt like they shouldn't have been in or that they weren't allowed in, and that's when their bizarre encounter with an alien happened. Our witness said, quote, we were walking down a hall and these doors opened and there was a very particular person or thing that caught my eye for an instant. This man was over 7 feet tall, I'd say between 8 and 9, even to 10 feet, wearing a lab jacket and talking to two human engineers. This man's arms were almost down to his knees. It threw me into a shock. It was definitely not human. He had big slanted eyes, a giant head, fingers were extremely long, greenish skin. I saw him just for a few seconds. 3/4 of its face is what I saw, and I said, this guy would make a hell of a basketball player, and then the doors closed. Security saw us and told us to get the hell out of there. The next day, I walked off the job. After that, I said, ain't nobody pulling the blanket over my head anymore, and I know what's going on now. I know what I saw at Edwards is real. Somebody's playing games with us, end quote. This guy is lucky he kept his composure until he left the underground portion of the facility before he made his real feelings known, because who knows if he had said something or quit sooner, or if he and his friend would have even made it out alive ever again, right? When he admitted to them that he wasn't going to have the blanket pulled over his eyes anymore, or whatever he said there, he became a risk to them. He sounded, even to me all these years later, like someone who would and was willing to talk about whatever had happened to them down there, and obviously, he eventually did. He's lucky they didn't take him out right there. I'm not laughing because it's funny, it's just like, wow, this guy's got balls. That same witness had another encounter after that one at the China Lake Naval Air Force Weapon Station, which is located in the western Mojave Desert region of California, of course. It's approximately 150 miles from Los Angeles. The base was originally named the Naval Ordnance Test Station, and it's involved in a bunch of different types of research, testing, and evaluation. Now, I thought it was a typo, the ordnance, capital O-R-D-N-A-N-C-E. I thought it was ordnance, but it's actually ordnance. I don't know. As a writer, that drives me crazy, but okay. I'm sure that it actually means something. I'm just not aware of what it means. That's neither here nor there. It's just sometimes I bring you guys down the rabbit holes with me. This place is sprawling and covers an almost unbelievable 1,100,000 acres of land, which is an area larger than the state of Rhode Island itself, and it has about 19,600 square miles of restricted and controlled airspace. According to our witness, this base also has a massive underground facility, but that this one holds not only alien tech, but the aliens themselves. He was working on something there with some colleagues when he saw the aliens again for the second time in his life and again on a military base. And he explained, quote, their security thought we had left, me and two other guys, but we had decided to stay over and finish the job. We walked past a hangar and we could see through the window. One of the guys I was with, Paul, he saw him first. He said, come here, hurry up, I want to show you something. And we looked in the window and there were these four little gray guys about 3 feet tall. Right then, security saw us and they told us, we thought you guys left. And they escorted us and said, you're not allowed around this hangar. This hangar is off limits to everybody. You'll get yourself shot. And it messed with Paul's mind so much that every chance he got, he snuck over there to look. He finally got caught and was kicked off the base. About 3 months later, they found him mysteriously dead in Orange County. This kind of put a scare in me. I know why not to mess with something. End quote. Keep in mind, I mentioned that earlier about this witness because I read that encounter first. It's kind of what they do, right? I've done at least 2 full videos on this channel recently about suspicious and strange deaths of people involved in ufology, and some of those deaths were of people who started off as nothing more than innocent witnesses, but who needed to know more, apparently, like Paul here. Could you imagine how that would affect you? I don't know how I would be able to stay away, to be honest. So this original interview was meant to be a one-time thing, but it generated so much interest at the time that they were going to rebroadcast it. However, right before they were about to do so, the KPFA-FM program director, a man named Ralph Steiner, told the network, quote, "Do not rebroadcast that tape. Persons whose testimony is on the tape have been threatened and their lives are in danger," end quote. I don't know if there was more than one witness here or if maybe they covered more than one person's encounter story at the time, because the manager was speaking like it was more than one person, but either way, I think they were talking about our witness. I believe wholeheartedly that our witness was threatened about coming forward with his encounters. And if you remember, he was terrified as it was because of what happened to his friend Paul. And so they knew exactly how to shut him up. He admitted on the radio in his testimony that what happened to Paul scared him. You think they weren't listening? What I've decided to end here with today is something I wanted to do a full video on, but I don't currently have enough information to be able to do that. And so this finally seemed like the best place I've had so far to talk about this. Motherships are something I talk about often in the live streams, specifically on Tuesday afternoons, and as I'm sure you've already realized if you watched my other video about military and battlefield encounters, some of the most amazing stories of encounters with extraterrestrials and their crafts have been had by military personnel. I mean, it's just my opinion, but I would go as far to say as it's just facts. In the November 1981 edition of the Flying Saucer Review, I found a strange case that was sent by way of a letter directly to the magazine itself. The witness was a woman who said she had a very odd and terrifying encounter out over the ocean with a gigantic cigar-shaped object. The witness didn't want her name being given out, and I don't think she included it with the letter or as a return address because I can still only find her being referred to as the unnamed female in all of the various places I found this encounter story retold and any information on it. She had been working for NATO at the time as an English language secretary, and she was based in Paris, France. She had been aboard an Air Canada DC-8 aircraft on a mission that had been sanctioned by the military with a group of 50 NATO personnel traveling from Paris to Canada for the NATO ministerial meetings in Ottawa. At the time, the plane was very far out over the Atlantic Ocean, and our witness was sitting in a window seat looking out and just enjoying her view of the sky. She was fine. However, suddenly something very bizarre looking, very out of place, and massively large caught her eye. How could it not? She said, quote, "I was just reaching down to take a book from my hold all and was astonished to glimpse below the plane something dark and absolutely tremendous that stood out in vivid contrast to the brightness all around. I could not believe my eyes. I pressed close to the window in unbelief, and there, almost beneath the DC-8, was a gigantic dark gray torpedo. It seemed menacing and frightening, and I had the impression that it was stationary. It was utterly unlike anything that I had ever seen in my whole life. It looked as though it was made of steel. No portholes or windows were visible, no wings or projections, nothing but the long, perfect torpedo form with its bullet-shaped head and the rear end, which was cut off sharply and squarely. The monster, and I emphasize that it was this terrifying size that impressed me, was well below us. I thought maybe 2,000 meters or so below us, but of course I had no way of being able to gauge this or estimate the size of the thing. I looked down again quickly at the monster and saw that a swath of tiny clouds was beginning to pass over it, though it remained visible through them for a few seconds before being lost to my sight," end quote. She was obviously greatly concerned by what she had just witnessed and looked around to see the reactions of the other 49 people in her group, only to find that all of them, every single one, were either sleeping, reading, or not paying attention to what was happening out the window. It seemed to her like somehow nobody else had seen the giant thing in the sky right below them. And at the time, she was afraid no one would believe her. And so she didn't mention it, as usual, for fear of being ridiculed, becoming an outcast, and or possibly even losing her job or eventually her life. She was not only confused but frustrated as well and had no real knowledge about UFOs at the time. Years later, though, she had gone on to read several books on the subject, and finally it was enough to convince her she wasn't crazy and that she had actually seen what she'd originally thought she'd had. She also started to make connections that weren't previously there because of all of the newly gained insight from all of the books she had read about it and all the research she had done, meaning she had read a lot about UFOs, okay, about extraterrestrials and their crafts. She had a more frightening aspect of the encounter happen after she had originally seen the object in the sky that she had never connected to the original encounter before. She just thought she saw this terrifying, strange thing, and then something weird happened. She never put two and two together. Why would she? Back then, it wouldn't have even crossed her mind. But anyway, she said, quote, "After my glimpse of the monster torpedo, I sat there brooding on it for half an hour or so, as I recall, when suddenly the DCH started to shudder and pitch up and down violently, nosing steeply upwards, then steeply downwards, and this went on for a long, long time. I might explain that I had often encountered turbulence and air pockets when traveling by airplane, which I did often, but it had never been anything remotely like this. This was as though we were in a gigantic lift that was shooting us up and down madly. And as though that was not enough, there now came a succession of reports like cannon fire or thunder that filled the cabin. Meanwhile, the plane continued to shudder and buck violently, and each time it came down, I had the sensation that it was going to just break in half. Throughout all of this, everybody in the passenger's cabin sat there petrified, absolutely silent, white-faced. After a while of this, I felt such panic that I rushed up in front to search for a stewardess, shouting, 'What's going on? I'm scared!' I lifted a curtain in front of what seemed to be a sleeping berth and found a stewardess lying on the bed there, her hands covering her eyes as though she were weeping. She gave no response to my shouts, and all around us there was total silence still, apart from the sound of the engines overlaid by the repeated claps of thunder and the continued bucking up and down of the plane. I went back to my seat and suddenly found myself bathed in perspiration. Every pore in my body seemed to be hard at work, and yet I noticed that the light dress I was wearing was still completely dry. A second time, I ran forward to the stewardess's quarters, but there was nobody there. I hammered on the door leading to the cockpit and shouted again, asking what was happening. I was scared to death. The other stewardess came out and looked at me as though I were an idiot, and for a while said nothing. Then calmly she announced, 'Ladies and gentlemen, do not be alarmed. The cabin is being depressurized.' Shortly afterwards, the captain was heard to make the same announcement." End quote. After all the research she had done, she suspected that the crew had been trying to cover up the incident after all, and that the two events were intimately connected. I had to look up what depressurized means, and it doesn't make sense for there to be no humidity in the air, that she was completely dry despite intensely perspiring for almost an hour, or for that stewardess to have seemed to be so overwhelmed by a seemingly normal and natural event, right? Depressurization isn't that uncommon, that she would be lying there weeping. She was a stewardess. Surely she had been through this before. Never mind all of the other issues our witness just happened to mention were going on at the same time. I've only ever been on an airplane once in 2010, and it was a relatively short flight from New Jersey to Florida. So I don't know what's normal and what isn't, not really. But I presume most of that isn't normal on a plane, or so many people wouldn't be flying all the time. Let me know. Plus, I'm sure our witness had been on many of those same types of flights. It was part of her job. The woman, our witness, continued by saying, quote, "I should like very much to know whether all that I have just described about the violent behavior of the aircraft and the loud reports is explicable as likely being due to the process of depressurization. And if so, what are the circumstances that are likely to have made it necessary for such alarming and drastic steps to be taken? Is this sort of thing usual and normal, as the calm behavior of the second mentioned stewardess seemed to indicate? And why in that case had the other stewardess, as it seemed, been weeping? Was this simply because she, like all the rest of us, found the turbulence a bit too alarming? Or is it possible that she was still suffering from shock after seeing the gigantic torpedo? It certainly would be interesting to know the answers to these questions. As for the plane's crew, there was only the one stewardess who seemed upset. What is certain is that the pilots up in the nacelle certainly would have had abundant time in which to see the cigar as it cut slightly diagonally across their route from their port side and well below them. No explanation or comment whatsoever was ever made about the cigar by the captain or any other crew member, and no statement was made by the authorities once we landed in Canada. We were flying under NATO auspices, and in that sense, we were under military control. In such circumstances, it would not be surprising if the cockpit crew and the stewardesses were less forthcoming about a UFO than perhaps they might have been were it an ordinary passenger flight, end quote. I'm pretty sure she answered her own questions. Any stewards or stewardesses out there? Do y'all see giant torpedoes in the sky that make the plane feel like it's going to break in half? I mean, I don't know. When it comes to the military, everything's so top secret and classified and just different. So how would we ever have a way of knowing unless someone from this flight happened to hear that report and commented? I did look for that, but I couldn't find it. I wanted to end there, but I figured I would give you all one more about this fascinating subject, motherships, at least in my opinion. This case involves a similarly enormous craft that had physical effects on a military vessel, and it happened, in all places, at the Bermuda Triangle, southeast of Florida. It was July 2nd, 1971, and the U.S. Navy aircraft carrier called the USS John F. Kennedy CVA 67 was returning to Norfolk, Virginia after completing a two-week-long operational readiness exercise in the Caribbean, and the people on board were taking some leave time before they had to head off for official duty in the Mediterranean for the next 6 months. This encounter was reported to the National UFO Reporting Center by an anonymous person who was at the time assigned to the Communications Center monitoring teletypes and printing the fleet broadcasts. It was around 8:30 one night when his equipment suddenly began acting up and seemingly going haywire, after which he soon realized that all of the communications on the ship were malfunctioning. Right after this happened, and while he was still trying to figure it out, he heard someone shouting that there was something hovering right over the ship, directly above it. He went up to some other personnel to find out more about what was happening, and that's when he and all of they saw something they were not prepared for and that with all of their training had no idea how to respond to. The witness said, quote, "As we looked up, we saw a large glowing sphere. Well, it seemed large. However, there was no point of reference. That is to say, if the sphere were low, say 100 feet above the ship, then it would have been about 200 to 300 feet in diameter. If it said 500 feet about the ship, then it would have been larger. At arm's length, it was the size of a beach ball. It made no sound that I could hear. The light coming from it wasn't too bright at about half of what the sun would be. It pulsated slowly from yellow to orange. We didn't get to look at it for more than about 20 seconds because general quarters battle stations were sounding and the communication officer was in the passageway telling us to get back to the communication center. We returned and stayed there. That was our battle station. We didn't have much to do because all the communication was still out. After about 20 minutes, the teletype started printing correctly again. We stayed at general quarters for about another hour, then secured. I didn't see or hear any of the messages going out about the incident. Over the next few hours, I talked to a good friend that was in CIC, Combat Information Center, who was a radar operator. He told me that all of the radar screens were just glowing during the time of the incident. I also talked to a guy I knew that worked on the navigational bridge. He told me that none of the compasses were working and that the medics had to sedate a boatswain's mate that was a lookout on the signal bridge. I figured this was the one yelling it was God. It was ironic that of the 5,000 men on a carrier, only a handful actually saw this phenomenon. This was due to the fact that flight ops had just been completed a short time before this all started, and all the flight deck personnel were below resting. It should be noted that there are very few places where you can go out in the open air aboard a carrier, end quote. That was hard for me to get through because a lot of the terms were very technical and I didn't understand. And I just thought it was funny when it said he told me that none of the compasses were working and that the medics had to sedate a boatswain's mate that was a lookout on the single bridge. I figured this was the one yelling it was God. I don't know why. That made me laugh. I had to recover. So our witness learned right away after this happened that it wasn't only the communications equipment that had malfunctioned the way it did, but that many other pieces of equipment on board had done the same and had started going haywire as well. The aircraft itself had even ceased to function while the object loomed like that above it. More ominously still were the quote-unquote men in trench coats, because of course there were, that almost immediately boarded the ship that were interviewing witnesses about what they had seen. And it wasn't said, but everyone knew that there was something secret about all of it. They knew, like, something weird and abnormal is going on. And they were probably scared. It all really did have such an air of secrecy to it, but nobody really understood why. I doubt after that experience any of them could understand much of anything, and even with them being in the military, they were probably more than a little scared. The witness continued, quote, "From what I could learn, virtually all electronic components stopped functioning during the 20 minutes or so that whatever it was hovered over the ship. The two ready caps, Combat Air Patrol, which were two F-4 Phantoms that are always ready to be launched, would not start. I heard from the scuttlebutt, slang the rumor mill, that three or four men in trench coats had landed and were interviewing the personnel that had seen this phenomenon. I was never interviewed, maybe because no one knew that I had seen it. A few days later, as we were approaching Norfolk, the commanding and executive officers came on the closed-circuit TV system that we had. They did this regularly to address the crew and pass on information. During this particular session, the captain told us how well we did on the ORE and about our upcoming deployment to the Mediterranean. At the very end of his spiel, he said, quote, I would like to remind the crew that certain events that take place aboard a naval combatant ship are classified and are not to be discussed with anyone without a need to know, end quote. This was all the official word I had ever received or heard of the incident, end quote. So basically, the crew, who had all been in through this strange and harrowing ordeal together, were told nothing at all other than that they needed to keep their mouth shut, and though it wasn't said, I'm sure there seemed to be an unspoken "or else" in that warning sentence as well. I've got two or three more encounters with motherships, but I'm compiling a whole list of them so that we can discuss them at greater length here on this channel in the near future. Let me know what you all think in the comments below, please, as always. And that's all I have for you today, guys. Please give this video a big thumbs up if you enjoyed the content, if you enjoyed hanging out with me, and if you enjoyed hanging out with one another, if you watched in the premiere. Spread the love by sharing this video, subscribe if you haven't already, and make sure your notification bell for all videos is turned on. Also, please, support the shorts. If you like the Intuitive Oracle, if you like the Oracle series that I do here on this channel, then you love the weeklies and monthlies that I do in the shorts. I also try to do funny things. I sing, I dance, I act goofy, I do skits, I'm silly. I want to get you guys to watch and keep you guys engaged. So let me know what you think about those. A lot of the times the comments are off because it goes out to the wider YouTube community, which is great because it brings more people in, but it also gets to more trolls. And I just, you know, I don't like the negativity all the time. People will just go out of their way to be so negative. So that's why a lot of the shorts you can't comment on. I leave the Oracle on. Some of them I will leave the comments on, but for the most part, you can just tell me personally if you liked it or not, or hit the like button, share it out. Like I said, you know, let me know what you all think. Please check out the description box for some important links, ways to donate to the channel, PayPal or Cash App, my Amazon wish list gift link. You can become a member for $4.99, for as little as $4.99 a month. The more members I get, the more member benefits I can give for you guys. Okay. The tentative schedule for the channel. Tuesday, this took me, by the way, an hour and 20 minutes to record, so as usual, I'm a little tongue-tied. Tuesday afternoon at 1 p.m. Eastern, it's Afternoon Swap with myself and Ghost Dragon ZW. Wednesday at 10 p.m. Eastern, Ghost Dragon ZW goes on for Chill and Chat. Every other Thursday, we have the Paranormal Pixie, Miss Lara. Friday nights, always Live Intuitive Oracle, of course, unless something comes up. And Saturdays at midnight, Ghost Dragon ZW reviews some of my old videos. Oof, I feel like redoing so many of them, but I'm like, you know, let me know if you want me to redo some of the videos kind of in my new style and with, I think I'm more polished now than I was. And, I just look back on those and sometimes I just grimace and I'm just like, ah, but anyway, that's the schedule. If something comes up, I will let you guys know through the shorts. So please check the shorts as well for updates. You're watching this video on April 1st, I'm taking the week off for my son to have spring break. I'm still going to be writing. I'm still working on my book, Gone, Mysterious Disappearances, where I talk about real, extremely strange disappearances that make no sense. And I put a paranormal and supernatural spin on them. So on April 8th, there will be no uploads. But just for that week, I'll still be doing Live Intuitive Oracle. I'll still be doing, like I said, behind the scenes, writing the scripts and doing all that for the next week. I'm still going to try to get some shorts done for y'all and just do what I do. You know, I'm doing the best I can. I could use a little break. My workload right now is really big. And I've been going without missing anything, without skipping anything for a really long time. So I'm sure you guys would give me the grace of that week. Guys, be kind to each other. It doesn't cost anything. Be kind to yourselves and never accept anything less than others being kind to you. If nobody told you today, you're awesome. You're amazing. You got this. You deserve abundance. It is your birthright. I got your back. I believe in you. Hit me up on my email, GemmaJadeParanormal@gmail.com. Don't forget links for my books on Amazon, Kindle, paperback, and audible versions of Missing the Fae Theory, Encounters with Evil, 101 True and Terrifying Stories, Shadow Entities, Sleep Paralysis, and Beyond Danger at Your Door, Encounters with Black-Eyed Kids, Midnight Visitors, which is the companion book to Danger at Your Door. It's just Encounters. All of those are Kindle, paperback, and audible. And on Kindle and paperback, you will find Campfire Stories Volume 1 and 2, which are real, true encounters in the woods. A lot of them sent in by you guys, okay, to my email. Send me your encounters for listener encounters, your encounters in the woods for the Campfire Stories series, because I do want to make those books a series of 12. Encounters with Evil, 101 True and Terrifying Stories, Danger at Your Door, Terrifying Encounters with Black-Eyed Kids, and Campfire Stories Volume 2 are all bestsellers. If you want them signed, hit me up before you make the purchase so I can sign them for you and get them out to you. Again, GemmaJadeParanormal@gmail.com for any and all correspondence. Always go in grace, smile at a stranger, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.